And one of the things that is very special about Trinity Sunday is it's the only Sunday in our liturgical year where we mark the doctrine of our church. And this is significant, I would say, because this doctrine of our God as a Trinitarian God is something that has become a revelation to the church over time. And the reason why, for me, it is so important that we mark Trinity Sunday is because it's the very heart of our faith. It's the very heart of our understanding of who this God is that lays a claim upon us, who this God is that we choose to love and serve as a Christian community of faith. And so we start by looking in Scripture at the self-revelation of God. And we know it in its traditional formula as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But more contemporary formulas talk about God as Creator, God as Redeemer, and God as Sustainer. And in the early church, this question came, how do we understand a triune God when we are a people who believe in one God? And this debate in the church took 300 years to be settled by the Cappadocian Fathers. And from that stems this understanding of God is an active God, that it's not three different gods operating. Okay, so tell us and close to you, we're not Hindu. We're not believing in more than one God. But it's important to understand the relationship between these activities or actions of God. That God is both creating, redeeming, and sustaining. And this is a consistent action that God is having in the world and in our lives. And we see this activity of how they are in relationship to one another in the beautiful reading we read this morning from Genesis, our first creation story. Because you know that there are two. Am I right?
Yes.
And the confirmation candidates could have preached this sermon for us because last week Sunday we were looking at the creation story and unpacking it. Or I could have asked Graham Paul to come and preach the sermon for us because he's done a wonderful job of talking about how the creation story leads to science and what it has unpacked. So we'll do that another time, but today you're with me. We see those beautiful words of when God created the heavens and the earth, it was formless and void, and the Spirit of God hovered over the deep. And God said, let there be light. And so we see the story, the activity of God, the creative activity, God the Creator, the Spirit of God hovering over the waters, and the Word of God, Jesus, being speaking creation into existence. And, you know, sometimes people get into this debate with one another about, is this a literal story? Is this literally how the earth was created? And I think to get into that kind of debate, you miss the beauty of what the story is trying to reveal, what God is trying to self-reveal in this creation story. I would offer, I love Archbishop Desmond Tutu's version of the Children's Bible. He opens the Genesis story by saying, God's love overflowed and created the world. God's love overflowed and created the world. Because this is a story less about when and how, and more about why. What is the purpose of this creation? Why did God choose to come to bring into being you and me, the stars, the earth, the planets? What is the purpose of all of this? And we see that God speaks this world into existence and he says each time that it is good. And we see in a story of beautiful synergy and intelligent design, as Ray Hall likes to speak about, a fine-tuning of the universe to create and sustain life. And we see our place in this as humanity. We see our interconnectedness to this whole web of creation, to this web of life, to this web of love. And we read in the Gospel of John, the opening chapters, those beautiful words, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Going back and taking that creation story and revealing even more about God's self and telling us that God so loved the world. And so we see on this Trinity Sunday that we are called to be in a loving covenant with creation, with God, with one another, and with all that God has made. And that we are called to revel and see that it is good, and that we are called to love all that God has made. But you and I both know that there has been a deformation of life. That as we look around and as we see the world that we exist in, that we have strayed from God. That we have lost our connection, not only to one another, but to this loving covenant that we share. And so the Redeemer speaks to us this morning and says to us, come and be in co-mission with me to restore, to bring grace, to bring healing, to bring mercy. Now, this version of the Great Commission in Matthew doesn't have the resurrection appearances that we've been looking at for the last 6 weeks. Matthew goes straight from the tomb where Jesus appears to the woman and tells him, go and tell my disciples to meet me in Galilee. And they go there, 11 of them, because remember Jesus has betrayed. They go to the mountain in Galilee, and we read that somewhat out to you. You must remember that for them it's only 3 days after the crucifixion, and they're wondering what is happening. But they go to the mountain, and Jesus meets with them there and says, all authority and power has been given to me. Echoing the authority and the power given to humanity in their first creation story. But this is not an authority to be overseen. This is not an authority that we wield power over. This is the authority that Jesus is given that works the works of healing and teaching in his ministry. And he shares that authority with us. That as the Father has sent me, I am sending you. I'm sending you into the world to co-mission with me as my to be those that are followers of my ways and of my teaching, to be those that listen to the wonderful restoration that God seeks, the wonderful grace. And I will never leave you, and I will never forsake you. So if you're sitting here this morning wondering what your purpose is in this life, this morning Jesus is telling you, very clear, your purpose is to come alongside me, to co-create with me, to continue this creating, redeeming, and sustaining of this beautiful covenant and relationship of love, this wonderful experiment of God's outpouring of God's love. But how do we do this? For those of you that came to our quiet morning last month in May, Reverend Matthew took us through this Great Commission and asked us the question, what does it mean to make disciples? What does it mean to grow the church? And we had varied believe, become. And I put it up there, belong, believe, become. I would offer that for us, disciple making is about creating a community of belonging. A community where people can come as they are, broken, wounded, happy, sad, up, down, come as they are and be accepted, belong to the body, to the family of God. And as we experience that sense of belonging, that sense that yes, we are home, this is our true home, then we can maybe start believing the promises of God's great love and grace and mercy. And as we start believing those, as we start experiencing them in our community of practice, then we start becoming who it is God has made us to be. The true us God calls us to be, to live in life and liberty in all abundance. Disciple making is about building up humanity. It's about building up the people of God. It's about allowing God's Spirit to flow in us. It's about bringing every need and aspiration, every desperation, every despair, every circumstance, bringing that into the loving light of God and allowing God to create, to redeem, and to sustain. And as we grow in this becoming the people of God, we are able to share that light with the world. We are able to share that light with humanity. We become a new creation. And so I'd like to offer that as we go into this week. I know that it's crazy out there. People are losing their minds. Some people have lost their minds. Things are tough. I don't need to remind anybody of that, and we are each one of us going through something. I'd like to offer that as we go into the week ahead, you just open your life, all your concerns, your anxieties, your fears, your hopes, your dreams. Open it to the creative, redeeming, sustaining power of God's great love and mercy. Allow that to be at work in your life, in the place where you need the most, so that God may use you.